Today on Spectrum, we catch a glimpse of Hawaii's surfing culture, as well as fine artist George Allan of Maui. Along the coast of the Hawaiian Islands, a graceful phenomenon occurs. It isn't restricted to this or that season. It arrives every day and every night. This graceful phenomenon is a force of immense power. Partially caused by natural forces that circle the planet, this wave of the Pacific Ocean has followed its course to Hawaiian shores, as have countless other waves in the centuries preceding ours. Early Hawaiian man found a novel use for these waves. He stood on a heavy wooden board, frequently made of koa, and rode those breakers for the sheer sport of it. As an ancient Hawaiian sport, surfing is believed to have enjoyed the favor of royalty. It has been called the sport of kings, as well as the most supreme joy. Early European witnesses of Hawaiian surfing noticed that the sport held its followers in a grip of devotion. Heedless of foreign visitors, careless of daily duties, the dedicated surfer felt compelled to enter the sea when the surf was up. To the surfer, the pleasure of Hawaiian waves provide their own reward. Nothing more is expected or desired. However, a sport so vigorous is bound to produce heroes, and surfing has its own. Paul Strout Jr. is a champion among surfers. Here he recalls his association with another world champion, Duke Kahanamoku.
Duke Kahanamoku was a very special man in my life. I had the good fortune of getting to know him in the mid-60s and became very closely associated with him in his latter years of his life. I've always admired Duke for what he stood for in representing Hawaii. He was one of the world's greatest swimmers, and of course his surfing prowess needs no explanation. Duke was a very special individual to me. I can recall several instances being with him and learning from his great wisdom. He had a novel style to his character that I can recall very vividly. Remember one incident, we were at Huntington Beach, and Duke was the guest of honor for the United States Surfing Championships. And at the award ceremony on the beach, after the conclusion of the contest, there were about 5,000 spectators there. And they called up the senior men's division and awarded the prizes from fifth up to first place. Well, they got to the third place award, called a gentleman up, and he came up, picked up his trophy, faced the audience, and threw it directly into a garbage can and walked off stage in disgust. I was really upset, and I was sitting with Duke, and I turned to him and I said, "How about that, Duke? What do you think of that guy and what he did?" And Duke turned to me and looked at me square in the eyes, and he says, "Gee, Paul, these guys really want to win, don't they?" And it kind of took all the wind out of my sails, but that was the kind of guy he was, a real special fellow.
Surfing also has its craftsmen, men who specialize in the design and construction of surfboards. The surfing style of today is largely determined by the size and shape of the board. Here is craftsman and surfer Ben Aipa, who is highly regarded in the field of surfboard design.
One of the most important things is the blank, you know? And when we get the blank, we check out the rocker, which is the curvature of the blank. Then I work on dimensions that is placed on the blank. Then I do a thing that is called a template. That's an outline of the board. And I trace it. It's like a pattern. Then I look at it, if it's something that I want or if it's not, I start changing dimensions. Then I do the template again, do an outline. And if it's what I want, then the whole process of shaping starts going down. You cut the outline of the blank first to get the curve that you want. Then you get a planer, a skill planer. And this is done to thin out the blank, thin out the tail to the thickness that you want. Then as the board is being machined, worked on, there's a finer point of shaping where it's done mostly by hand with a shear foam blade and with sandpaper and a sanding block. And this is done by a lot of feel, a lot of eye, a lot of craft type of shaping, which is very important to get what you want. For the ideas that I come across with, basically it comes from an everyday surfer. Like I put a lot of time in the water. I see kids surfing and I see how they're riding and I try to adapt a design for a different type of surfing. So these ideas all come from the surfers themselves. Then when I come back to the shop, to my shaping room, I try to put it down by numbers and put it down into the blank. Long time ago, when people was making surfboards, they had no fins. They were made of wood, and they were very heavy. And it was very difficult to shape, very difficult to ride. And now with the modern type of lightweight foam, it's a little more easier to shape, and the boards are much lighter. Then there's a bunch of multi-fin systems that changes the characteristics of the board for the different type of surf, the different type of surfers, different type of wave conditions all over the world. And I feel this way that although the cost of the surfboards are high, it's still one of the cheapest form of artwork.
My artwork started out when I was extremely young and just carried through all my life and carried it over here in Hawaii when I left Florida, and just one day I told myself I wanted to be an airbrusher, so I'm totally self-taught. Didn't really ever go to anybody to have lessons or anything. I've been airbrushing for about 4 years now consistently. Right from the start, I got very busy and just kept going all the way through. All this paper taping takes up most of your time. More paper taping, the more it costs. It's a lot like auto body painting in that you're just masking off all the areas in accordance to what colors they get. Right here, I'm taping off these areas that are going to be getting pink and blue and white, and the background will be a lavender with black pin lines around each square. Paints are water-based. A lot of people would have to measure it, but I've been doing it so long that my measuring's all by eye. Very important to have smooth, even strokes. Oh, a lot of my work is my own. I try to get them to leave it up to me. It's a lot more fun that way, but I do a lot of custom work. I like trying to get things just the way people ask for it and make them happy.
Very glad to be glassing Ben's boards and being out in the country here on the North Shore. I've been glassing boards for 20 years, and this is the place I want to be. Being in the forefront of the surfboard movement with Ben, he's pushing new shapes, new concepts, and he wants the glassing to be very light and very strong. And to do that, we have to have the most modern materials available, high-tech fiberglass and resin that give us a high strength-to-weight ratio. We keep up on things like popular mechanics, popular science, things they're using in the aerospace industry are being carried over into the surfing format today. And this is allowing people to use smaller surfboards, lighter surfboards, do maneuvers that were heretofore unknown. Compared to other things like painting or making instruments, surfboard making is just as much as a handcrafted art as any of those things. However, the pay scale is much less, so that if someone was to get into making surfboards as a profession, as a career, weighing the risks versus the monetary benefits, it wouldn't be a very attractive thing. He could do a lot more creative things with his hands at a much less risk to his body, and perhaps make more money. So that the people that are involved with making surfboards today are really a idealistic type of person who are pursuing something they really love. And in our society, this seems to be a breakaway thing from the mainstream, whereas people are generally looking at the almighty dollar as number one, and secondary would be their enjoyment or their devotion to what they're doing. So we feel kind of proud to be separate in that way, that we're doing things that we really love.
Painters are drawn to the water as well as surfers. In Maui, fine artist George Allan has gained a reputation for his renderings of Lahaina Harbor, as well as other maritime scenes. Spectrum visits Maui to join George and Janet Allan as they begin a typical day.
Get away and take a little trip. Here, you've lived here 10 years, and you haven't even been to Molokai.
Oh, I landed there once at the airport. That counts, doesn't it?
Well, that's not the Lava Valley. I mean, gosh, that's beautiful.
Yeah. Let's do it.
Hello? Oh, hi, Terry. Sure, just Terry. A sec. He's early.
Yeah, you're early. Gosh, couldn't you sleep? No, that's fine. No, that's all right. The 8x10s, yeah. Boy, they got them done in a hurry. Oh, that's terrific. Well, I can't get in until later, around about 10, after breakfast. All right? Right, mate. Okay, see you later. Thanks for calling. Bye now. Okay, I got to get going.
Oh.
I'm going to take a run. All right?
Oh, okay. Well, where will I see you?
Pioneer Inn, but I'm going to take some photographs first around town while the light's good.
Oh, okay.
That's fine. Yeah, love. See you later.
Bye.
Come on. It's funny, but when you're a painter working visually, or a photographer, or anyone that's working visually, I think, feels this. You seem to be switched on 24 hours, never off. You're always looking, always composing, always seeing paintings and colors. Running up here in the field seems to be the only time I can put that aside and just feel things, meditate. I'm very happy up here. Let's say it's a spiritual start to the day. Difficult to imagine starting to paint or going to the studio without checking the traps first. By that I mean spending some time around the harbour or the streets of Lahaina, chatting with friends or other artists or people on boats. It seems to reinforce the fact that I belong here. It's a good solid feeling. I like to talk, and if I didn't have this contact, I'd be forever running out of the studio looking for someone to talk to. I take hundreds of photographs. I've always enjoyed photography. It's mechanical and chemical, and it's magic and fascinating. You have to be careful that you don't spend so much time looking through a viewfinder that you lose touch with what's really in front of you, what's really there.
George's wife, Janet, is his business manager. She makes the schedules and sees that George keeps them for paintings, exhibits, and gallery shows.
So don't forget today, sometime.
God, I've been forgetting about that. I meant to call him.
And while I have your attention, can I talk to you about your new brochure today? They're about ready to go. And so I wanted to make sure that you didn't want this other cover.
Yeah,
I didn't know if you might want that cover instead.
But that's not really typical for you. I like this painting a lot. I think that's a really good one. But I don't think it's really typical. That's more typical.
I think they could probably lighten it up a little bit.
Yeah, maybe. If they could, that's great.
Okay.
Otherwise, it's all right. What's the inside like? I hope you're not still flogging along that Carthaginian thing. That's getting really old.
Speaking of the Carthaginian, you haven't finished that painting yet, have you? Because as soon as you finish it, I have somebody who wants to see it. I'd like to just sort of get it up on the wall.
You really want to sell those things when they're still wet? That's awful. I'm going to go out and finish it as soon as I finish here. I've got to go and see Terry first about some film.
Oh, well, let's see.
And I'll get out there.
Maybe to save time, I could go set up the easel on the wall and the painting's real wet, isn't it? I got to be careful.
Yeah.
Okay, so I'll go set that up. I'll meet you out there. And then I gotta run. So
right.
I'll meet you on the wall then.
All right, love.
Okay, see you later.
Bye.
Microphotography is the rendering of objects from an extremely close point of view. These types of photographs have become George Allan's guide into the field of abstract art.
Well, I want you to know your enlargements are in.
Oh,
let me get them for you.
Are they any good? Have you checked them out yet?
Checked them out.
You sneak. Oh, that looks all right. I can do something with that.
You doing abstract?
What do you think? Yeah, they'll be abstract. More abstract. That's pretty good.
All right, great. Now, I've got one other thing for you.
Oh, I knew it.
That camera with the winder.
You're always trying to plug me something.
I wanted you to take a look at that.
Oh, great. This is fabulous.
Oh, it's really beautiful. The light on the water is great.
Right now it is. In half an hour it'll be finished.
Oh, I'm trying. We'll go to any length to get him to paint.
The light's never been better. For the summer, it's incredible. Yeah. Just as well, it's early enough. It's really good. Look at the light on that, the reflections under the boat there. And see the way it sort of glitters underneath the boat there?
Yeah.
Yet that reflection carries on all the way across here. You can see it right through here.
Yeah.
That's what I'm trying to do right now. Sometimes you can work it really good. Sometimes it just doesn't do it, but
the light changes so fast.
Yeah, it does, but if you work fast, you can manage it. And this little boat here today is just beautiful. God, there's always a surprise out here. Every day I can come out and get a new surprise. It's just beautiful.
That water.
Oh, yeah. And people doing things. There's so much energy in this harbor. It's just you can't help but sort of try and do something with it all. Oh, you do?
Yeah.
And have I got the posts straight this time too?
Well, yeah, they are straight.
Oh, thanks a lot.
The Pioneer Inn has never leaned better.
Well, I think when I'm painting here, I think I overemphasized everything when I really analyze it. Everything is exaggerated. I think it comes out on the painting a lot more real than if I just painted exactly what's there. I think I see in more brilliant colors than normal. I don't know.
Well, I guess I really better get on and get to the printers and
I'll meet you later back at the studio, I guess.
Okay, love. You want to take this with you?
Oh, golly gee, thanks a lot. Woo! Well, anyway, okay, all right.
Bye.
See you later. Bye.
See you back at the studio.
I loved to paint the Carthaginian. I helped bring it from Scandinavia in 1973, so I've got rather special feelings about it. It certainly looks better now than when we arrived. My association with Lin Chu has been long and rewarding. Here I became intimately involved with working artists for the first time.
Yes, I have some.
Learned how to go about making a living out of it.
Great, that's
good. But they want a coil frame on it.
Always nice to sell one. Yeah, that'll be great. I can do it. Sure. How long do they want?
About a week.
I can do that. That's fine.
Good. Yeah, it looks wonderful here. I've rehung the gallery. What do you think?
Oh, it looks great. You've done a good job.
Bill Bagley's work is new. What do you think?
Yeah, really nice.
Like it?
Look at that. Look, the red against the green. His paintings always excite me.
I enjoy hearing your reaction to the work that's hanging in here, George.
Oh, yeah, there's a lot of my favorites in here. That's for sure.
Here, I've rehung Keith Lindbergh from Carmel's Wall. What do you think?
Oh, good. Yeah, I hope he comes back soon and paints. It's always a joy
to
watch
him. Looks like she's sitting on the beach.
Really? All this chaotic color going on around here and such serenity in the subject matter. Look, this one, too.
Yeah.
Just beautiful. So serene. You wouldn't think it would work that way, would you? But it does. He makes it work. That's an artist.
He's dynamic.
Oh, yeah.
Hiroshi Tagami brought in a new
really
koi painting,
nice,
too. What do you think?
Yeah. Great. That's the way he, all this neutral color with just little pieces of color in the middle. He's,
the strong sense of them swimming.
And the way he frames his work, boy, he's been an inspiration to all of us with that. So dynamic and yet so peaceful somehow. It's the same with his abstracts here. So peaceful, but there's so much going on. All these warm colors. And but it really works.
Yeah.
It really works. This center of interest over here, and it seems to branch out into just beautiful shapes. It's really nice. Oh, here's some new
together.
Dick Nelsons over here. Let me see. Oh boy, it's this transparency is really something. I love it when I can work along with him.
Richard Nelson's classes have been really helpful to everyone.
This flowing lines, the way he makes it all flow, and he just uses three colors, but he makes it work so well.
It's
it really
amazing,
takes courage to do that.
Really?
You can't do it with oil painting, I don't think. I've tried, but I can't get it. Look at this one here.
Yeah.
The way he uses subject matter and makes it really work, but it's just a beautiful abstract painting.
Yeah.
Just really
his
beautiful.
His fluidity is just exciting.
Uh-huh. Yeah, really.
But he's not my favorite painter.
Oh, come on.
Look where I hung this. Isn't that great?
Oh, that's good. Yeah, it looks nice there. It really does.
I love that morning look you get in your paintings.
Mm-hmm.
The atmosphere is just beautiful.
Well, that's the time of day. I don't think anyone can go wrong if they get out there early in the morning. It's just so beautiful out there. The mountains are just at their very best, I think, and the reflections. The color of the water is beautiful that time of day, you know. And the people doing things early in the morning, all the energy going on, it's just hard to miss, you know.
Yes.
It's just a great place to be.
Gorgeous. People are drawn to your work.
Mm. Oh, well.
Because they would love to be in that boat.
That's
just
right.
Just floating around.
Yeah, I wish everyone could be, you know. It's really...
Look at this new Lao Chun.
Oh, look at all that
look
texture.
Look at the color
all
in this.
All that great pink going on there and the color.
The texture just grabs you. It's very strong.
Really.
Lao Chun is really a fine artist from Oahu.
Yeah. You have a number of other editions too, eh?
Yeah. That's
cool.
Really good one.
Well, Lynn.
Well, what do you think? Going to take that and reframe
it?
Yeah,
I'll take it in now,
good.
And I mightn't get it done today. But
next to the Village Gallery is George's studio, where he enjoys painting abstract art to the sound of music.
Thank you.
inventing an innovation or what I get a big charge out of. A number of years ago, I came to the realization that the paint on the palette was visually as exciting or even more so than the paint that I managed to get on the canvas. So I've been trying to find ways to interpret this excitement and put it down some way.
When George Allan responds to his world, he oftentimes acts as an interpreter. If he is interpreting a form of excitement, then the possibilities are numerous. What is it that draws men to the sea? Surviving passage in a boat? Challenging the waves on a board? Or hoping to capture some aspect of its beauty and majesty? It is a mystery with many reasons, but no explanation. Join us again for our next spectrum.
Thank you.